article in our constitution in respect of bail. But when you read Article 13.2, it's very clear. Article 13.2 safeguards the right of personal liberty of citizens. And when it comes to Article 13.5, Article 13.5 says every accused is presumed to be innocent until he is proven guilty. And I think when we read these two articles, bail also is impliedly introducing these two articles. So can you explain us relationship between the presumption of innocence, personal liberty and bail?
Well, Darshana, first thing is you have to understand the basic concept of a criminal justice system. Criminal justice system is there for two reasons. Number one, anybody making any interpretation on the criminal justice system and the requirements will have to necessarily bear in mind the social order and the maintenance of law and order in a country. That is on one hand. On the other hand, what you said, the presumption of innocence is extremely important. Presumption of innocence is something that our courts have applied throughout centuries. Where do you strike the balance? When a criminal offense is committed, there are different, the law, the bail law also recognizes different types of offenses, bailable, non-bailable, and very seriously non-bailable. You have to understand the fact that there are, when a crime is committed in society, certain crimes will have an impact on the society as well. It will have a continuing effect or a continuing impression. So therefore, even though the concept of fundamental rights, now we all know fundamental rights came into the legal system of this country for the first time in 1972, after the 1972 First Republican Constitution. Then came the 1978 Constitution, which has Article 13, and you were speaking about Article 13.5. So a court of law, there's a balancing factor. When a person is at first point, now what do I do? When a person, every person is presumed to be innocent. Every person has the freedom of movement. That is something that you are entitled by the Constitution. Now, who can curtail? Your own conduct. You can curtail your freedom by your own conduct. Why do you have to curtail? The necessity, actually, we have to understand this is something that we'll go on as we embark on this exercise. Number one, you have to understand if a person is arrested and once he is in custody, the simple question that the judges will have to decide, is his detention necessary? Is his remand necessary? Is his remand necessary for the purpose of proceeding with the remaining steps of the investigation? So what I say is, the balancing factor is something that the judges will have to very carefully and cautiously apply.
Thank you so much, sir. My next question goes to Mr. Yuvada Silva. Sir, now, when Bail Act is concerned, very important section is Section 2 of the Bail Act. It says guiding principle in the implementation of provisions of Bail Act is that subject to certain exception, granting of bail should be regarded as the rule and the refusal to grant bail as the exception. So therefore, yeah. I think it is very important and it becomes very important to distinguish the rule from the exception. My question to you is, sir, can you explain where does this rule end and where does this exception begin?
It is very clear when you go through the Bail Act, it is stated that the bailable offenses and non-bailable offenses, and there are some important areas where they say that if the particular act states with regard to bail, special provision is there, and then the Bail Act does not apply. So on that basis, we can go on. And earlier, Criminal Procedure Court carried a special area where bail is concerned, Section 402, 403, and 404. So those are important areas where, as far as the criminal procedure is concerned, and then Section 115 also very important with regard to bail. Here, of course, we have implemented a special law with regard to bail. As you said quite correctly, the Internet Particular Act, it is stated that the bail is a law, and then the grant him bail is a law, and then refusing bail is the exception. And then the magistrate, earlier, the bailable offences, magistrates are bound to give bail. Section 402 is very clear with regard to that. But with regard to when the Bail Act came into operation, there is a special clause given by the Bail Act, Section 40. But it is there to have a guideline only. But most of the cases where we think that bailable offences also, this police officer concerned, that the OIC of the police station, he is not ready to grant bail under Section 402 or under Bail Act, because he thinks that it is not his duty. And he says that because of the Section 14, we are not going to give bail, and you have to make your application there in the before the magistrate. So that is the very reason the Bail Act will not operate according to the legislator. It is very clear that if you have a case coming under Bail Act, then the OIC concerned, that is why we say bailable, the OIC of the particular police station is in, they are to grant bail. So the non-bailable means that OIC cannot grant bail. You have to go to magistrate court, and magistrate has the discussion to grant bail. As far as the other important acts are concerned, if there is a bail provision, they are inside the act, then the Bail Act does not apply, as I told you. And then if there is no specific area where the Bail Act bail provisions are there, then we have to go through whether the sentence is important. Because if the sentence is more than below the 3 years, it's a bailable offense. If it is going below, going over 3 years, then of course the non-bailable offences will be there. So that is how we have to make our application. My request would be that most of the areas where we are concentrating, the OIC concern can grant bail, as you quite correctly pointed out in your opening remarks, that remand prison is burdened with a lot of people because of the police not adhere to this particular section. So we have to inform them quite correctly that they have every opportunity to grant bail. But if they are not going to do that, it's a problem. It's violating the fundamental right also. And then another important thing I would like to say, our Criminal Procedure Code states compoundable offense. Even for compoundable offenses, the OIC concern put forward the person to the magistrate. So my idea is that the magistrate doesn't have the jurisdiction to hear those cases till the police officer, if he is not in a position to compound the case, and he has to refer it to the mediation board. If the mediation board says no, only the magistrate can take up the case. So that is how we have to go further. Before that, we have to consultate whether the magistrates are going to hear those cases without asking the police to send them with bail. And then if the magistrates are not going to hear the cases, and if magistrate says that I am not going to hear the cases because of those cases are coming under compoundable offenses, you better go to the mediation board and come back, then we can curtail most of the cases without going to magistrate courts.
Thank you, sir. That I will now turn to Mr. Mohan Veerakon. Sir, now, as Mr. Yuvadasilla sir said, sometimes police officers do not exercise their right given under Section 6 of the Bail Act, even if the offense is bailable. Can you tell us as to how the OIC should exercise his powers under Section 6 of the Bail Act, and what are the instances that OIC can refuse bail even in respect of an offense which is a bailable.
Yeah. Yes, Darshana. Now, this section 6 is very clear in the Bail Act. It says the it says like this. Now, if the OIC thinks that the public reaction to the offense will cause a breach of peace, he will definitely have to produce that accused before a magistrate. That is the basic principle there. So, these bailable offenses had been there before the new Bail Act also. So, it had been there. It had been there where the police were allowed to grant bail to people who are involved in traffic accidents, not fatal, general things. They were allowed to grant bail for those people. So that is the situation even now. But mostly, you know, in most these rural police stations, not only in the rural police stations, even in Colombo or suburbs, a small matter like a 314, 315, 410, 386, all those things, misappropriation, all these matters, the people are very serious about it. So they go and complain and they harass the OIC of the area, the accused people represent the accused, then people represent the prosecution, and there are a lot of influence used on the OIC. So he basically files the B report to the magistrate court and produce the accused in the magistrate court. But my thinking is that before this new Bail Act, bailable offenses, the law was that bail had to be granted at the first instance. That was the law. Then non-bailable also, the maximum days that a man could be in remand was 15 days and nothing more for the investigation. That was the law. But the new Bail Act of 1997 changed all that. Section 14 give a lot of ambiguity to the magistrate and the police, where bailable and non-bailable, both offenses can be, the magistrate can remand a person for bailable and non-bailable offenses now. And if they really want to keep a man in remand, they can keep a man in remand for 2 years. That can happen.
Thank you so much, sir. And recently, DIG Mr. Ajit Rohana said that those who are arrested for violating curfew law will no longer receive police bail. And there are allegations against some of the OICs in some of the police stations that they do not exercise their powers fairly and they misuse powers. What is your experience with regard to this, Mr. Mahanwar?
That is what I explained earlier also. Now, it always depends on the OIC of the station. Now, if he thinks that this man should be produced in court, he will produce a man. If he thinks
if the OIC misuses his powers, is the remedy that an accused person or suspect person has?
I think he should file a FR application, but my personal feeling is that.
Thank you, sir. And I would like to ask Professor Jeeva Niriyalla, madam, you have more than 27 experience as a lecturer, and you also have done research on this subject. My question to you is, what is the purpose or purposes behind granting bail, and how does bail help a suspect or an accused?
To answer to your questions, I want to look at this particular question in the three main angles or the perspectives. The first one is the philosophical or the jurisprudential perspective. The second one, the rights-based perspective. And third, as you said, that the practical perspective, how it supports to the person who is enlarged on bail. If you take the first aspect, that is the philosophical aspect or the jurisprudential aspect, as you are aware that Mr. Kalinga in the thesis started that, stating the right is given bail and the exception is the refusal of bail. So it clearly shows that the purpose, to my understanding, why it is so important, because person is taken into custody, that person's liberty stop at that time. So then if you take the philosophical or the jurisprudential angle, you know that you can see there is a very basic norm that we adhere, or the principle we adhere. Everybody even that we don't have the tapera, that we don't have the rights and the duty and all these things, where we call the medieval period, or even prior to that, based on the people took the decision based on social norms. One, the particular norm is there, that norm is presumption of innocence. Until that the person is proven guilty or he admits his guilt, so no one can actually keep the person behind bar without any the reasonable reasons. Therefore, if you give the answer to your question, yes, take the philosophical point of view. In order to achieve that or to reach the particular norm, that is presumption of innocence, yes, therefore you have to enlarge the person on bail. If you take that, there are a number of cases, Australia, UK, USA, especially Balchand versus the state of Madhya Pradesh, you can see that how the especially Justice Krishnaya focused the reasons through that, the guiding principles behind that granting the bail to a person, suspect person. So then, as an extension to this philosophy, you can see that today, after the Universal Declaration, which is applicable to human rights, and that is we call Universal Declaration of Human Rights, then thereafter, you see that 1966, it was adopted by UN, the ICCPR, we call the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. Thereafter, a number of other international instruments tried to protect the rights, so civil rights of the people. I want to specifically focus on the civil rights of the person. So then what are the civil rights of this particular person who is being taken into custody? So then he actually has with you then the human rights, when it is converted into the fundamental rights level under the written law in Sri Lanka, in India, we have the written law. When it comes to UK, you can see the unwritten law. So then even though the UK has the unwritten law, their rights are well protected with regard to the suspect, the accused. So then when the person, the liberty is deprived, so then he has the right to request or that claim for bail. Why? Because unnecessarily you cannot put the person behind bar. But as Mr. Kalinga Indathis very correctly pointed out, there must be a balance between the civil rights of the society and the civil right of the particular individual who has been alleged to committed for an offense. So therefore, in order to, protect the rights of the civil rights of the person, yes, until proven guilty, he can claim enlarge on bail by the court or the police, but subject to the protection of the rights of the civil rights of the society. Number three, more importantly, that is the practical aspect. What is the practical aspect? You started in your opening remarks saying that, yes, overcrowding of the prisons. Actually, I can remember, I have done a research in 2010, one decade back. So then I saw that the overcrowding percentage actually, the 400, that means where you take the ratio, in relation to the premises of the closed prisons. So then the premises that you can take one person, but there are four people are located there. Why? The reason many of them are unconvicted prisoners. Unconvicted means in the sense the remand is without, granting bail on them. So then there are four. Now, if you grant them on bail, what can actually, while we are, protecting their rights, we can let the people to stay in the society. We can actually save the public money, right? So they are fed by the public money, tax from the taxpayers' money. And actually, indirectly, I don't know whether you have seen that sometimes mothers are taken into, custody. So if the person can be enlarged on bail, sometimes mother and father both. So then they can stay in the society with their the family members. But we have to make sure that these people, when the court requires, when they are, they make sure that they are come to the court for the legal proceedings. That is, therefore, if you take, I summarize once again, there are three angles I want to look at. Philosophical angle, the second one is the rights-based angle, the third one is more practical. Let the person to go to the society, then let the person to stay in the society and do all the other work, right, other than that the crimes. But and so then have, giving that particular opportunity so we can reduce other lots of social issues. More important.
Your answer is very clear, madam.
Overcrowding of the prisons. Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much. Your answer is very clear. Mr. Kaling in the thesis, sir, are you in agreement with Professor Jeevani Riyalla, or do you want to add anything to her? What is your experience now when a man is remanded, awaiting trial, how that affect his right to a fair trial?
No, I have to agree with Professor Riyalla for a number of reasons, but I will add certain reasons to that as well. Now, initially, if you look at this forum today, all of us are defense lawyers. You can't talk about the concept of bail only through defense lawyers. Remember that. Because that's what I said. Now, when a person commits an offense, what is known as a crime, even though that crime may be committed against an individual or the society in large, it is considered as an act against the state. Every criminal offense or crime is considered as an act against the state. So, what is bail? That is the first thing that we have to understand. What is bail? Bail is releasing the suspect concerned from the custody of the court to the custody of the sureties. The basic concept of bail is to ensure that the person who is suspected of an offense attends court or comes back to court whenever the court wants him. That is the guarantee that any suspect would have to give the court. So, you are talking about the law envisages two situations. Number one, pre-trial detention and detention during trial. Pre-trial detention, Darshana, is necessary only if it is absolutely necessary. That is where Professor Niriyalla's observations become relevant. There is a psychological aspect, there is a theoretical aspect, there is a criminology aspect, and there is a practical aspect. So therefore, a man can be detained, pre-trial detention should be limited only for one purpose, that is facilitation of investigations. Now, U.R. De Silva very correctly cited the situation prior to 1997. Before 1997, the Bail Act came, there were two situations, investigation stage, inquiry or trial stage. Investigation stage was governed by Section 114, 115 and 116 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Inquiry or trial stage was governed by 402, 403 of the Criminal Procedure Code. The maximum period, as Mr. Mohan Veerakon, President's Counsel, identified, the maximum period that an unbailable suspect could be remanded was 15 days, unless there was further material emanating within those 15 days in the course of the investigations. AG versus Sepal Ekanaga case decided that. Now what happens? The earlier law was, bailable offenses, you have a right to get bail. Non-bailable, there was a discretion. Non-bailable offences of a serious nature, the magistrate's court was without power and you had to go to the High Court or the Court of Appeal depending on the nature of the offence. Today, what is the situation? Section 14 Bail Act empowers a magistrate to remand a person even in the case of a non-bailable offence or in the case of a bailable offence, if the grounds are there. So, I think that is not very satisfactory. As Professor Niriyalla said very rightly, and as Mr. Yuvadisar and Mr. Mohana Veerakon was trying to point out, why should we remand people? Pre-trial detention is only for the limited purpose of facilitating the investigation. Now, for example, it depends on the nature of the offense. That is what the honorable judges will have to understand. When you exercise the judicial discretion, you look at the facts. Don't make orders for the sake of making orders. You have to look at the facts. You have to strike a balance. And at the same time, what do you mean by looking at the facts? If I am arrested for a particular offense, if my detention can facilitate the investigations only, I should be remanded. If my detention doesn't mean anything, the investigation can proceed even if I'm out. I should never be remanded. That is what is called judicial discretion. So what I say is, now if you go through Professor Nidhiyal cited the constitutional provisions, one of the most important cases in the history of bail is this In re Athrupana's case, 51 New Law Reports. We never had the concept of fundamental rights or human rights at that time. The human rights concept have evolved thereafter. So Article 13 very silently speaks of the situations of a right of an accused also. When it comes to bail, when I say silently, it is inherent in the article. So Article 13.3 read with Article 13.5 gives you some guarantee by the state. So what I say is, there is nothing magical about making orders of remand or bail. All what the judges will have to be thinking is to strike a balance between the two and also not remand unless remand is absolutely essential.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I would like to pose this question to Mr. Uar da Silva. Sir, now an entirely novel concept was incorporated into the Bail Act number 30 of 1997, which is the concept relating to anticipatory bail. How does this concept operate and what are the offenses for which a potential suspect can make an application for bail in anticipation?
So when anticipated bail is concerned, that's a new concept. Bail Act comes into power. It has been there to get the bail as anticipated bail. So firstly, we must know that when we are applying for anticipated bail, it has to be a non-bailable offense coming under Bail Act. So if it is not a non-bailable offense, then you can't go to anticipated bail application. And if it is not inside the Bail Act, you can't do a anticipatory bail act. So firstly, you have to have a petition and affidavit with regard to that. And remember, the important point would be the suspect or the person who is applying for the anticipated bail should not be there. Most of the lawyers, they ask the client to come over there, and when the inquiry stage, after one week's time, the inquiry will be held. During that inquiry, if the police is objecting for that, sometimes the magistrate will straight away remand that person. So you have to be very careful. And the other important thing is you have to inform the OIC concerned about your bail application and anticipatory bail application, and then only you can file your bail application there. Once you file the anticipatory bail application, you can inform court what is the alleged offense you are suspected to have. So if there is no offense there, then you can't support the application. You can't go there and say, I hope that I will be taken into custody. No, you can't do that. You have to come out with the alleged offense that is coming under a bail act, and it should be non-bailable offense. So if it is there, then the magistrate will issue summons to issue notices to the OIC concerned to come within 1 week. So then when the OIC sends their person or he himself can come over there, and after the inquiry, the magistrate will decide whether to allow that application or not. This is how it goes. And most of the areas, we have to be very careful. We can't file anticipatory bail for murder cases, drug cases, and then public property cases. So you must know on what situation the anticipatory bail application can be filed.
So what are the factors are taken into consideration in deciding granting anticipatory bail or refusing anticipatory bail to a potential suspect?
The main issue is when the police comes and say that this is not the person we are interested in taking in custody, then the application cannot proceed. If the police says that this is the person we want to take this person into custody, then the next question would be, what is the offense? The offense is the same offense or graver than that. Now, if the police comes and say this is coming under Public Property Act, then you can't proceed with that. When the police comes and say that it is a drug offense, then you can't proceed with it. So likewise, if it is coming under Bail Act, as I mentioned earlier, and it is an unbailable offense, then thereafter you can proceed with the relevant areas, and the judge will ask the police what stage of the case. So if the investigations are going on, and then we want to go take more evidence, and then only we can see what is the position. Thereafter, the magistrate will see whether it is prudent to release this person on anticipated bail, or sometimes he will say, I am not allowing the application, so that the application will be dismissed. So then you don't have to worry about that, because your client was not there. So if the client was there, then it will be a problem, because the magistrate has no option to remand that person.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to turn to Mr. Mohan Veerakorn. Sir, I have myself visited many prisons in different parts of the country, and what I have observed or noticed there is a lot of people are held in remand for their failure to comply with the bail conditions, especially the cash bail ordered by the court. Can you explain what conditions can be imposed on a suspect or an accused in releasing them on bail? Is the discretion vested entirely upon the judges in deciding the condition? And so what factors are taken into consideration in deciding such conditions? Especially we are a country, many people are poor.
Yes, Darshana. Now, talking about this, I just want to add something to what Derwan said about this anticipated bail also. Yes. My thinking is that anticipatory bail is to stop someone from being falsely implicated in some offense that he did not commit. That is, was the intention of the legislature. But in Sri Lanka, something files and goes on a goes to court on a anticipatory bail matter. That is what happens in Sri Lanka. Because my personal experience is that these anticipatory bail applications, I rarely support these things, and it's a big fuss. That's my contention where in Sri Lanka is concerned. Yeah. Now talking about this bail and talking about bail and the cash bail aspect of it, the discretion is solely with the judge. Now you take cases like the drug cases, murder cases, where the bail is ordered by the high courts. You have to go to high court to get bail in these offenses. Public Property Act, all those things, you have to go to the High Court. So once you go to the High Court and High Court grants bail, invariably it is cash bail. Invariably it is cash bail, quite a high amount, sometimes very high amounts. So the man comes out on bail, after about 4 or 5 years he's outside, then he comes to court again, then the court, most of the high courts, then again order cash bail. So that man is, it's like double jeopardy for him, because he has to furnish bail twice. I think this concept of cash bail should be done away with, and you have good sureties, you have the sureties, and when a surety signs as a guarantor, he undertakes to produce the accused in court, and if he does not produce the accused in court, there's a procedure where the bail bond can be forfeited. His property also can be sold. So that is the easier concept, when without blocking a lot of cash in the court houses, we can come to a point where the court orders surety bail and allows a man to go out.
I think you have explained it very clearly. I think in the court of appeal, in the case of state of Pathirana, emphasized that bail order should be reasonable, and the entire purpose of bail would be negated if the bail order is excessive, if it is not within the reach of the suspect. Thank you, sir. I would like to come to next. Professor Jeevan Iriyala, madam. Now, there are certain laws, statutes, where there are specific provisions governing bail for offences committed under such acts. What are those statutes or acts where there are special provisions for bail, and what do you think was the intention of the parliament in excluding such statutes from the ambit of application of bail application?
As all the speakers very clearly pointed out, directly and indirectly, the purpose of granting bail and refusal bail acts between rights of the society, the people, and the individual person who has alleged to have been committed the particular offense. So when it comes to that, you ask that there are some specific statutes, right, which are mentioned, that is, this, they are not come under the purview of the Bail Act. So then if you go through that, the Terrorism Act, the Offensive Weapons Act, the Firearms Ordinance, and more recently the Ragging Act, the Property Act, you know, there are, if you see this under Section 3, the exception says that the any other written law which refuses the bail. So if you go through the, should I say, all the statutes, so that's, I mean, there are,
I would like you to concentrate on the Ragging Act, madam, because okay, you are a right. professor.
Yeah. So then we have to see that the purpose of the drafters of enacting that particular statute, right, to protect the society. It is there. If you take the drugs of the act, and if you take the offensive act, so then if you take the firearms act, so on and so forth, you can see that it's the protection of the societies, the basic objective is that. Since you asked the questions in relating to the Ragging Act, you see that you and I and many of other university or the tertiary educational institutions, we were the students there. So you can see that ragging is going on. Still it is going on. We have Pasindu, and there is another Pasindu now. He's still who's in the hospital. So then in relation to this ragging, actually, we have to look at in the different perspective. Why? Because we are talking about the educational institutions. If the people who are in the educational institution, if they engage in some sort of the offensive acts, which is clearly mentioned, Section 2 of the Ragging Act and Section 4 of the 5, 6, 7, and so on and so forth, it is mentioned that what are the offenses can be committed and that particular ragging act. Unfortunately, the definition of ragging is not given. Agreeing to that, you can see. So then the Section 9 of the Bail Act say that, right? So then bail can be granted by the magistrate, but there are some exceptions. The two exceptions are in that particular act committed by whoever that, you know, maybe a student, maybe an employee, it is come under grievous hurt under the penal code, or else if it is come the offense, the sexual harassment, or the taking as the refugee, or that then what would happen if a person who is committed such act, the bail cannot be granted. The reason, if you take the sexual harassment, if you take the person as the hostage, taking him as a hostage, and these are some kind of activities. It does not mean that others should, they can do, but these are serious nature of the offenses that they can commit. So therefore, when it comes to the Bail Section 3 of the Bail Act, to my the reading, then some of the statutes are specifically taken away from the scope of the Bail Act. Why? If you go through,
that it gives. Thank you. Thank you. Your answer is very clear. And I would like to turn to Mr. Kaling in the thesis. Sir, now, once a man is convicted for a criminal offense and is sentenced to a term of imprisonment, presumption of innocence does not operate anymore in his favor. But he can also file an appeal against the conviction and sentence and seek bail pending appeal. But it is so sad to say, sometimes court insists exceptional circumstances for bail, even the term of imprisonment is 2 years or three years. Can you explain what are the factors that judges should consider when granting bail to a person who is already been convicted? When anticipated bail is concerned, can you explain that? What are the exceptional circumstances that an accused has to prove? established.
There are two matters that I will have to explain. Number one, I want to make a very brief comment with your permission on the statement made by Mr. Mohan Veerapan, President's Counsel, on the question of anticipatory bail. Anticipatory bail is a new concept to the Sri Lankan law. It was introduced by Section 21 of the Bail Act. I will not share the view with Mr. Veerapan that it is useless. I say it's very important. If you understand the basic concept of anticipatory bail, it originally started from Canada, came down to India, and we have adopted that in 1997. What is wrong is not the concept of anticipatory bail, how it is looked at by the courts. I will tell you why. If you go by the judgments of India, Indian judgments, you will find anticipatory bail is extremely important in a country where there is a lot of political corruption and political influence on the police and the investigators. If a political personality has the capacity to induce the police authorities to implicate his political opponents and others falsely, there is no basis or no other forum that he can look up to in asking for relief. That is the basic concept in India. So I say, with all respect, anticipatory bail is a very important matter, but how it is applied, I have my reservations, because now some of the judges have the tendency to say, if a B report is filed, anticipatory bail has to be withdrawn. That is not correct. That is not correct. In India, it doesn't happen that way. In Sri Lanka, it should not happen that way. Whether a B report is filed, otherwise what the police will do is, the moment a person files an anticipatory bail application, they'll file a B report. You can't ask the attorney of the suspect to withdraw that, because that's a separate application which has a new conceptual right, which is conferred, a statutory right, which is given under Section 21. Now, you spoke to me and you asked me the question on this bail pending appeal.
Bail pending appeal.
Right. Now, what is bail pending appeal? Where did we get that from? If you go to the history, you will recall, you will know, Darshana, that until 1880s, Sri Lanka or Ceylon then did not have any statutes. The Criminal Procedure Code, original code, came in 1880s. The Penal Code came in the 1880s. Evidence Ordinance in 1895. So we were guided by the English law principles. What was the thinking of the English judges at that time? A man who is convicted by a court has no presumption of innocence any longer in his favor. That presumption has been rebutted by his conviction. And once a man knows that there is a sentence over his head, whether he has appealed or not, the chances of him thinking of jumping bail or absconding thereafter without waiting for the hearing of the appeal is much more, because you know that there is a positive sentence. That is the thinking. Now, how did that enter into our legal system? If you go through the legal authorities, you will find the Levin New Law Report. Talahaina murder case is one of the earliest cases where exceptional circumstances were spoken. So at that period, remember, Darshan, there was no statutory law. There was no statutory law. One of the earliest statutory laws which came regarding bail is the Court's Ordinance. Court's Ordinance adopted the English law principle of bail pending appeal on exceptional circumstances. We never had a statute. Even our law, if you look at the provisions, now there were two different clear situations. A conviction from a magistrate's court, a conviction from a high court.
From a high court.
Yes. If the conviction was from a magistrate's court earlier, prior to 1997, you have a right to be enlarged on bail the moment you file your petition. Otherwise, there is a judicial discretion. So why my thinking is this, the concept of exceptional circumstances is something which was never part of our law, imported to our legal system through the English law principles. And in 1997, the Bail Act was presented to Parliament by Honorable Professor G.L. Pierce, who was the Minister of Justice at that time. If you go through the preamble and Section 2 that you spoke of, granting of bail shall be the rule, it doesn't say at appeal stage it will be a different rule. Granting of bail shall be the rule and refusal is the exception. So you go by the same concept. Now what happened? Sections 19 and 20 of the Bail Act, those are the two sections where you have provisions of law relating to bail pending appeal. In those sections, the word exceptional circumstances is no longer there. It was never there in the earlier law. It was a judicial invention or judicial following, I would say. We followed blindly what was applied in England. Section 19 and 20 of the Bail Act also doesn't contain that words, exceptional circumstances. Justice Sriskandaraja, in one judgment, he said it is no longer part of our law, but that was overturned by the Supreme Court.
Supreme Court.
Therefore, in my view, a court of appeal or the Supreme Court looking at exceptional circumstances, we have one matter to look at. Number one, how long would this appeal, a few matters to look at, how long would this appeal take? What was the conduct of the accused during the preliminary hearing in the High Court or the original court? Did he attend court? Did he continuously attend court without absconding? If that conduct can be considered, sufficient bail can be taken. He can be released on bail because you know what happens, Darshan, is this, when a man is taken into custody, I know of people who have spent 8 years in remand, 5 years after conviction, 13 years of your life is lost. And there is no compensation mechanism where the state awards compensation even if it's. What I say is, it's very pathetic. Judicial discretion has to be, I think Mr. Veerapan will agree with me and Professor Nidhiraj Lodge will agree with me. There must be a system where people are brought to justice. Because otherwise no one takes, this system is not accountable. That is all what I have to say.
That is true. Darshana,
may I be permitted to add something to this, right?
Yes.
Now, I won't take a lot of time. Now, our constitution, section 13, 3 and 5, right? Right to freedom. Now, some of our special laws, there are 13 special laws that does not come under the Bail Act, right? Bail Act. Those 13 laws, some of them antiquities ordinance, right? Mm. No bail at all.
No bail at all.
If the commissioner's letter is there, saying that it's an archaeological site, right? There are no bail. And the heroin cases, if it's more than 2 grams, people are incarcerated for 5 to 6, 7, 10 years sometimes. Bail is refused. I have never seen a case where bail had been granted by the appeal court from the High Court, where the quantity has been about 10, 15 grams. But those people are not indicted. Those cases are about 10, 15 years. So they are being punished already. So what is the purpose?
That is exactly correct. I would like to turn to Mr. U.R. De Silva. So now, as far as bail is concerned, as Mr. Kalimithi said, that discretion is mostly vested on the judges. Therefore, judicial discretion has a major role to play in bail applications. So when you consider the existing bail laws in Sri Lanka, can you explain as to what extent judges are vested with discretion? Do they have absolute discretion or are there any guidelines as to how they should exercise their discretion?
Can I answer that?
Yes, please.
Yeah, what is your question, Darshana?
My question, as far as bail is concerned, the discretion is mostly vested on the judges. What do you think about this concern? Are there any guidelines that judges should follow when they exercise this discretion?
You go back to the same thing, Darshana. Prior to the Bail Act, there was different set of grounds. And now Bail Act, now the judicial discretion is dependent on Section 14 of the Bail Act. Now the situation is, after the Bail Act came into operation, even in respect of a bailable offence, if any one of the grounds in Section 14 are there, a court can remand. Non-bailable, you can grant bail or remand. Bailable also, you can grant bail or remand. Now, there are 4 grounds identified under Section 14 of the Bail Act. Now, what was the situation prior to 1997? There was no Bail Act, but there was judicial discretion. I believe the discretion is important for every judge, and judge must retain the discretion. But what is important is exercise of that judicial discretion in a manner that the judicial discretion is expected to be exercised. Now, prior to 1997, before the Bail Act came into operation, judicial discretion was guided by 2 simple judgments. One is reported in 12 New Law Reports, page 65, Rex versus Toussaint. And the other one is reported in 65 New Law Reports, page 389. That is Queen versus Lianagi. Now, these 2 judgments collectively has the cumulative effect of identifying 4 grounds, Darshana. 4 grounds on which judicial discretion must be exercised. Nature of the offense. It's a simple thing. You can look at the nature of the offense by the B report, and the magistrate must go into the B report and find out whether that offense is committed. Seriousness of the sentence, that is black and white. If you know the offense, you know the seriousness of the sentence. Probability of conviction. Now, this is where the judges will have to exercise their judicial mind. Just because somebody files a B report and says, I am a police officer, remand him, you can't do that. Probability of conviction is something that you can look at prima facie. You can't make a decision at the pre-trial stage. Yes, but you can always, Darshana, you can always look at the evidence and see how it is. Then the other thing is, what you have to say is, nature of the offense, seriousness of the sentence, probability of conviction, and possibility of absconding. What is your character? What is your conduct? Law says everybody is equal, but everybody is not equal. But they have to be treated equal by the mechanism. That is what the law says. For example, can you hear me?
You can continue, sir.
Yes. Then that is what I say is nature of the offense, seriousness of the sentence, probability of conviction, and possibility of absconding. Is this a man who is likely to abscond? Now, how do you know whether a man is likely to abscond or not? By looking at credentials, looking at his position, his previous conduct, his status, may be wrong. But those are the guiding factors in every judicial system. Those are the grounds of judicial discretion ought to be exercised.
Thank you, sir. I would like to turn to Professor Jeeva Niriyal. Madam, now it is clear that general public is not very happy about the current law relating to bail. They always tend to criticize. They are of the opinion that system works only for the rich and the influential people. What do you think is the reason for this mindset? People are not happy with the existing bail law, current system. What is your opinion?
That is actually, Darshana, this is you asking my opinion.
Yes.
Is doing research and as a layperson, not as a practitioner, I'm saying that in order to have, you know, people have a not faith, but do they lose the faith because of, if you see that if they are unable to see that they are really protected by that law, so then they lose the faith. So then under Bail Act, who are the protected people? One hand, the society. The other hand, the accused. So then we were talking about, you know, how the rights of the defendants were, the deprived. So to my understanding, I want to little bit add to what Mr. Karlinger in the thesis said. So then other than this, the Rex versus Toussaint and the Queen versus Lienegay, yes, that the judges actually can discretion when you, I mean, they exercise their discretion. It's a clear guidance given even in the section 14, to my understanding, where you can release bail. If not indirectly, what it is said is, yes, you grant bail. That is my reading is. So then they lose the, they feel that they are not protected. I'm referring only to the Bail Act. So then there is a gap between the law and the practice. And there are some lacunas in the law itself as well. So because, you know, when it comes to the exercise of the given discretion, I think that if there is a very issue here, so then what you have to do is we have to bring a reform in order to minimize that. Then give some sort of guidance or how they have to, I mean, utilize their discretion in that way. So therefore, there is a gap between the law and practice, and there are the lacunas in the law itself substantially. So therefore, these are the reasons when it is really, I mean, make the people to consider they are not protected by this, the law. However, I want to say that with regard to the enactment of the newly enacted, the Victim Protection Act, I just want to tell you that number 4 of 2015, it actually gives some sort of the confidence that, you know, the support of even the law, the bail law, should be, I mean, the exercise, the given discretion exercised by the magistrate in a very meaningful manner. If you read these two, the statutes together, you can see that. So this
Thank you. Thank you, madam. I will direct my final question to Mr. Mohan Veerakon, as we are running out of time and we have received many questions also. Mr. Veerakon, there are countries that have already reform their bail laws. But recent studies show that there has been an increase in new crime rates after the reforms. How safe it is to release suspect or accused back to the society? How do you think we should address these issues through reforms? What are the reforms that you suggest to balance two objectives, safety of the society and the personal liberty of the suspect or accused?
Darshana, now, the earlier question was the same more or less now. That is where the discretion of the judge is very material. Now say a previous man who has 10 previous convictions or offenses, right? Will, once you put him out to society, he'll be a menace to the society. So it is always best to keep a person who has 10, 15, 20 convictions inside if the offense warrants that. But basically our law is such where the constitution is enshrined in the constitution, and the bail act or the preamble specifically says granting of bail is the rule, exception is non-granting. So basically when you take both together, people have to be released on bail. Keeping a man in remand is not a punishment. He had not been punished by court, and the presumption of innocence is there. Article 5 of the constitution also. So my feeling is that these laws have been, especially the Bail Act has been put forward. The act has been enacted for the simple reason to ease the congestion in court, the prisons, and send people out on bail. But I don't think it happens. It happens in the breach more or less, because with this new Bail Act, more people are being remanded before the 1997, before 1997, if in a murder case the plaintiff is not filed in the magistrate court within 3 months, the magistrate had the jurisdiction to grant bail for murder. Now it never happens. So sometimes now a murder accused in a simple murder case even will be there for about 6-7 months, 8 months till the non-summary is concluded. So that sort of things have to be addressed to reduce the people in the remand custody.
Thank you, Mr. Kalinginathi, sir. Sir, what are the reforms that you suggest to existing bail laws?
Yeah, I think the Bar Association has taken the lead to do that, because sometime last year we appointed a committee chaired by Mr. Anil Silva, President's Council, and I think Mr. Mohan Veerkun was also part of member of that committee.
Yes.
They have given me a very comprehensive report, and that report has been sent to the people who matter. So what do we do? Number one, the exercise of judicial discretion, we were talking about judicial discretion, Darshana, is extremely important. You can't take away that discretion from a judge. But what is important is to identify the proper guidelines on which that discretion will be exercised. Because we have to understand, now lawyers complain. We as lawyers, we complain of everything or most of the things. Now, when you walk into a court, Darshana, you may have one case where you have to make an application for bail. But a judge will have to hear more than 100 cases that day. So the judicial time is limited. But judicial discretion is important. But what is missing in Sri Lanka is proper guidelines. Those guidelines for the exercise of judicial discretion has to be identified. I believe the Bail Act has to be relooked. The concept of bail pending appeal has to be relooked at. Whether you must balance the right of an accused with the rights of the society, as Professor Nijayala pointed out. It's very important that there's a balancing factor. Then at the same time, anticipatory bail concept must be enhanced, not only to non-bailable offenses of a general nature. Even murder cases, you should be able to get it. Unless you want to keep a person in remand to facilitate the preliminary investigation. Now, for example, that is the matter that the judges decide whether the suspect before you is a person who can have an impact on the investigation. If the answer is yes, you may detain him. If the answer is no, then you have to release him. That is a simple exercise that has to be followed. So therefore, we'll have to look at the anticipatory bail concept, operation of Section 2, whether the preamble to the ordinance has been complied satisfactorily by the judicial system. Then also Section 14, we'll have to relook at it. Then Section 19 and 20, we have to relook. This is my thinking on any reforms which are necessary.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. I would like to, we have received some questions. We have received a question from Attorney at Law, Mr. Ranjan Nayakaratne. I would like to direct this question to Mr. Mohan Veerakon. Sir, in terms of Section 6(1) of the Bail Act, the police shall not be required to produce the suspect before the magistrate only if the proviso comes into operation. The suspect shall be produced before the magistrate. In reality, most of the suspects are just produced before the magistrate. If the B report does not reveal the facts suggesting that proviso is applicable, is the suspect entitled to be released on bail as a right? What is happening day to day is magistrate remand the suspect without examining the applicability of relevant provisions of the Bail Act. I also have a question. Now, sometimes police just come and say investigation is pending. There are certain other investigations to be carried out. Therefore, they ask to remand the suspect. What is your experience and what is your opinion on this?
My experience is what you say is correct. Where even a bailable offense, sometimes the police come and say they don't write that there will be a breach of peace and the people are worried about it. Those things will not be said. But they will file a general B report saying that man had been injured and that person is to be remanded. He may be remanded. So that automatically happens. But what I feel is that, like Mr. Indrajit said, Section 14 must be amended where bailable offences, when a man is produced in court, he must be released on bail, then like the olden days before 1997. And the police also, they can use their discretion to release a man on bail from the police station itself on a written guarantee where he gets a date to come attend the magistrate court. And if he does not attend court on the day required day, he can be arrested and he can be punished. He can be sentenced for 6 months and fined 100,000 rupees also. So that is already there. So basically in some of these, like I mentioned earlier also, traffic accidents, simple accidents, non-fatal accidents and all, police invariably grant police bail. So that is the situation where the Section 6 applies. So that law is already there. And what the police normally do is to wash their hands off and produce most of the people in the magistrate court. That's what happens.
Thank you. Mr. Kalinginda Thissa, sir, are you in agreement with the observations made by Mr. Mohan Veerakon? Do you have anything to add, sir?
No. Apart from what I suggested to you, I think Mr. Mohan Veerakon has a very valid point there.
Yes.
I agree totally.
And I would like to ask this question from Professor Jeeva Niriyala. Madam, now under the Assistance to and Protection of Victims of Crime and Witnesses Act number 4 of 2015 is concerned, who is defined as a witness? Now, there is a definition in this act. Who is defined as a witness according?
It is very clearly mentioned who are the witnesses of the particular case.
Yes.
To see show you the distinguish between the main evidence ordinance and this particular act. When it comes to the witnesses and the assistance to and the protection of victims of crime and witnesses, actually, it is specifically focused on the two types of crimes or the violations, whether they're the disputes or something, whatever that you know. But number the criminal offenses, right? Number two, when there is a violation of either human rights or the fundamental rights. So if a person whose rights have been violated or when the person is subjected to any crime, be the victim under this particular act. So they, first of all, can be a main witness to that particular the case. So there it is specifically mentioned that under Section 46 and under Witnesses A, it says that the person who has informed something, that's an information relating to the violation of human rights or fundamental rights or of his or another person whom he knows and has some sort of the interest. That is another important thing. And submit that the related information to the commission. So then the issue arises, what do you mean by commission? It is also mentioned in the interpretation clause of this particular act. So then the person who has submitted the lodged complaint, who has submitted the information to the particular the commission, yes, they can be a victim of under particular act. So in addition to that, the person who is really believed that he will be called as a give some sort of information or give some evidence as in relation to the human rights violation, the fundamental rights violation, and a commission of any particular the crime, yes, they that person also can be considered as the witness of this particular under particular act. So then likewise, then the potentially that the believe that the person will be called upon, but what or this particularly mentioned in the commissions can be considered as witnesses. In addition to that, the person who is really subjected to the particular the offense or the any kind of human rights violation may be the witness of the particular act. I mean, very interestingly, right, it says that it includes, right, the victim of crime, the child witnesses, and the parents, the guardians of the related, the siblings, all can be considered as witness of this particular act. So it's a broadly given an interpretation to the witness of under this particular the act.
Thank you. I would like to direct discussion to Mr. Kalingi in the thesis, sir. Now, as far as discretion, when the discretion is exercised, when judges refuse bail, judges should give reasons. But in practically, we see in most instances, sometimes without giving reasons, judges remand people. What is your question is, what is your experience and what is the remedy that an accused person has if the judge is not given reasons?
Section 15 of the Bail Act makes it imperative.
Yes,
that reasons must be given, because if you go by now, if you look at Section 14, Section 14 contains the grounds on which bail can be refused.
Yes.
Bail can only be refused on these grounds, not on any other ground. It was interpreted in the case of Anirudh Rathore v. Attorney General, 2003 SLR 839, the judgment. Now, you must understand, reasons, giving reasons is extremely important. And if you don't give reasons, that is, in my opinion, an illegal order. I remand is not enough. I remand the accused is not enough. You must give reasons in conformity with what is there in Section 14. Every step has to be answered. Otherwise, it's an illegal order.
Thank you, sir. And I would like to ask from Mr. Mohan Veerakorn, sir, can a court remand a suspect who is currently held for non-bailable offense when the police fail to file a further report seeking to extend the remand period? What is the judicial discretion in this instance?
In that case, the judge should release him on bail, but it never happens. That's the problem.
And I would like to ask Mr. Kalingi in the thesis, sir. Now, as far as the anticipatory bail is concerned, there is a question.
Yes.
Now, can a murder suspect also seek anticipatory bail? Like, this law is clear. If you can explain what are the instances that you can't seek anticipatory bail?
Yeah. Yes. Now you have to look at first. Anticipatory bail applications are made under Section 21.
Yes.
It applies to non-bailable offences. Non-bailable offences where the judicial discretion is vested with the magistrate's court. Murder is an offence which is punishable and triable by the High Court. It is not an offence which is triable by the magistrate's court. Under Section 13 of the Bail Act, wherever the offence is one which is punishable with death or life imprisonment, your bail application is to the High Court. So, anticipatory bail is only in respect of non-bailable offences triable by the High Magistrates Court, not in respect of any other offences. That is why murder is not in a situation where you can file an anticipatory bail application.
Thank you, sir. And we have received an interesting question. I would like to direct this to Mr. Mohan Veerakorn, sir. Now, even before the court of law convicts a suspect or accused, our media convicts him. Unfortunately, judicial mind has been jeopardized by media institutes and social media. Is this a serious issue as far as suspect rights are concerned. What is your opinion as to how we can tackle this issue?
I think it's a very serious issue. The social media, as well as the press, they really, if I use these words, they really go to town on. They take a side, they support one side, they support another side. So in Sri Lanka, generally everyone, most of them are on social media, YouTube and newspapers, a lot of people read it. So the judicial mind can be convinced this way or that way by listening to something day in and day out. I think we need to bring in laws to stop this, very serious laws. And before about 15 years back, we had that section 484, criminal defamation, that law was taken out from the penal code. So I think that law should have been there, because the presently what is happening in this country, no one is accountable, and only remedy is to file civil action, and that takes a lot of time and money.
Thank you. Can I just make a reference here?
Yes,
sir. Darshana,
yes, sir.
Now, you will see, if you take some of the Sinhalese newspapers out, today something happens, tomorrow morning, the statement made by the suspect to the police officer is reflected in the newspapers. Right? During our time, there was a media which was very responsible and accountable. Freedom of expression doesn't give you to report anything in conflict with the law. There are certain basic norms. There are certain basic norms even in journalism. Right? That is, you report what can be reported. It is very unfair for people to be judgmental on newspaper reports. You create a prejudice, as Mr. Veerapone said. You create a prejudice in the minds of the court, in the minds of the people, and you have convicted the person or acquitted the person, either way, very much prior to the trial. Now, you are talking about journalists. This morning, I must say this, an attorney at law has published a particular post on Facebook, which we will be dealing with, announcing to the general public that if anybody has any matters, to consult him and put his phone number. So we are going, that's a very appalling state. You are talking about journalists, I'm talking about lawyers. That has to be stopped. People, public, and the media cannot play a role in convicting people. So that I hope that you have answered your question.
Thank you. I would like to ask Professor Jeevaniriyala, Madam, now, when a judge considers a bail application, rights of the victims should also be considered, or the bail application should be considered only on the merits of the case? Should the court consider the rights of the victims as well?
If you ask me the question, the rights of the
victims.
Yeah, it is very clear that Section 3 and the Section 4, it talks about the entitlements of the victim, and the Section 3 talks about the rights of the victim. It says that the victim has the right to see that what is happening, the progress of the case, whether the person is enlarged on bail, and whether that he has any, I mean, the accused can put any danger on him or him and interfere with his the evidence and all. So therefore, I think that today's scenario, when the judge actually takes the discretion, the act also should be taken into consideration, because it anyway it includes in the Section 14 the given the four items there. So then you see that if there is, you know, any interference done by the potential interference can be seen in relation to this particular accused of the defendant. So definitely that can be, have to be considered. The rights of the victim means that.
Thank you. And I would like to ask this from Mr. Kaling in the thesis. Sir, in some courts, judges adopt methods such as expecting a suspect to pay an initial amount of compensation to a person injured before bail is being considered. Mostly in cases regarding motor traffic accidents, when the position of the suspect is being innocent in such matter, these type of methods are highly disturbing and sometimes cause a huge fuss. What are the methods which should be adopted by a lawyer to counter such incidents? This is very common in our courts.
Number one, payment of compensation or payment of any monetary consideration can never be part of a bail condition. It should never be, it never was, it never ought to be. It is wrong for a court to impose as a bail condition payment of conditions, payment of monetary consideration. But in an accident case, there is provision to pay, make compensation payments. So if in a real accident, without tying it up with the bail condition, the court can always inquire from the accused or the suspect and then pay it off as a compensation, part of the compensation process. Don't tie it up with the bail condition because it can never be a bail condition. Payment of any monetary consideration should never be a condition for bail. So what the lawyer should do is object to that. And if he refuses, go by via revision. We will help them to create a judgment which says, now you will know that there's judgment from the Magistrates Court of Kaduvela. Kaduvela, there was some payment of compensation which was ordered, condition was ordered, recovery process, and there they said, Magistrates Court is not a recovery court in that sense. Therefore, you can't do that.
Salam's judgment.
That's a Salam's judgment. So that is the operational law. So bail, you can't tie up with the monetary consideration judgment.
Thank you. I would like to direct this question to Mr. Mohan Veerakon. It is also a very interesting question. When some judges, when granting bail, impose some conditions like direct the accused to or suspect to observe SIL, donate some money to certain institution, can the judges impose such conditions?
They can't impose conditions like that. It is, if you ask someone to donate money to a charity, that is bribery. And if you ask a person to go and observe SIL, that is against his beliefs. If a person might not go and observe SIL, how can you do that?
What is your opinion, Mr. Kalinga, in the
thesis? No, I agree. I mean, you can't. How can you ask a suspect to observe SIL? Right?
And
you can impose a community service order at the end of the case.
End of the case. If he's convicted.
At the end of the case. You can't have these conditions to bail. No. Role of a judge is not to clear all the issues in society. He has to do justice. He has to dispense justice. You can't be clearing each and everything. And also what I say is, you can't ask suspects to go and observe SIL or charitable organizations. That is bribery, as Mr. Veerakon pointed out.
Thank you. There's another question. I would like to direct it also to Mr. Kalinga Thisa. If a murder suspect who is mentally ill and who does not have money to furnish cash bail and who does not have relatives to produce as sureties and who is in remand for over 14 years, what can a person in this situation can do? And some reform supporters argue that cash bail should be totally abolished. What is your opinion on this?
Cash bail, in my opinion, is a very unsatisfactory state. But at the same time, you have to remember there was a problem. In the 1980s, courts used to accept, Mr. Veerakon will remember, courts used to accept deeds as certified bail. But then what did our people do? They forged deeds. They forged deeds and kept forged deeds as surety for bail. So every system can be abused. But what I say is, the main consideration for a judicial officer who is exercising discretion in the granting of bail is to make sure that the suspect stands before him whenever wanted by that court. You can't put an amount of money on that because you can deposit that money and escape. There is nothing. All what you do is you take sufficient sureties who are acceptable to court. 14 years in custody on these conditions is a real crime. And I don't think anybody will be accountable in this country. The system will not be accountable. The enforcement authorities will not be accountable. But in such situation, I don't know what he had been doing for 14 years. If he was legally represented, the lawyers ought to know better. They should have brought it to the notice of the Commissioner General of Prisons or filed an application to have this man out. If he's mentally ill and if he has no money to pay, he shouldn't be there for 15 years, 14 years, as you said. That's another crime.
Pathetic situation, I think.
If there were lawyers representing him, they are also responsible.
It is a very sad situation. I would like to ask Mr. Mohan Veerakon, so now, what is the procedure in cancellation of existing bail order? Should the judge give reasons to cancel the bail order, or without giving reason, can a judge cancel existing bail order?
A judge can't cancel an existing bail order without giving reasons. And those reasons have to be very strong reasons. if police come and say that there was a complaint again that this man threatened the witness or something, that is not sufficient to cancel a bail order. Section 14 is very clear on this. There had to be serious investigation done and the facts have to be reported to the court. Then only a judge can cancel an existing bail order. There are decided judgments also on that. You just can't do that.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And I would also like to ask Mrs. Professor Jeeva Niriyala, Madam, now can you tell us when children are concerned, what is the, as to how the court should deal in granting bail or deciding bail application, especially young offenders are concerned?
Actually,
how court should deal with their bail application?
The court should actually be a very child-friendly one, because I mean, I don't know whether you refer to the juvenile court or the normal, the courts which function
juvenile
as
court.
Juvenile courts, actually, we have only two juvenile courts there.
Yes.
Do is and Bhattarmulla and Jaffna. So what they have to do is they have to consider that so their future and whether what is the, as I mean, whatever said and done, finally we comes, you know, round and round, come to the same point. So then to the child offenses, offenders, we have to consider their the immaturity, the young age, as well as their the future and the perspective as well. Therefore, they have to considering all these things, but of course that they have to of the offense, and I mean on one hand the gravity of the offense and the other hand the nature of the particular person alleged to be committed the particular offense. Therefore, considering those factors, their immaturity, the level of education, what they can, whether they are understanding and their capacity and all these things, is have to consider when they, I mean, grant the bail on these people, because children are a different set of people. We consider them as vulnerable set of people. And you see, if you take this Article 12 of the Constitution, the special reference is given to children, women, as well as the disabled people. So therefore, they have to take into the consideration of that fact as well. So when you grant the bail.
Thank you so much. I think, well, time is running out on us. Let me conclude by thanking all of our panel members of the panel for giving all the participants excellent insight onto the question that we've raised. And I would also like to extend my thanks to Mr. Rajiv Amarasurya, Secretary of the Bar Association of Sri Lanka, Attorney at Law Pasindu Silva, Management Committee and the staff of the Bar Association of Sri Lanka for organizing today's webinar. And for all the participants who join with us for today's discussion. And I would also like to remind the participants that next Saturday also, the Bar Association will be hosting a webinar at the same time. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Darshana. Thank you very much, Roy, and all the panelists. On behalf of the Bar Association, I thank everyone. And I also want to mention, I have answered all the questions that they have put on the question and answer session. In writing, the answers have been provided.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.